Here I want to talk about food security in Indonesia, mainly for discussion. And I link with the international food trade. Japan is the world, so you know where is Indonesia. Indonesia is here. Philippines is here. There is similarity between Indonesia and Philippines in terms of there are many islands. If in the Philippines there are 3,000 islands, is that correct?
7.
Indonesia has 13,000 islands. This is the main island, Sumatra, Java, Kalimantan, Sulawesi, Maluku, Papua, dan Suan Nusa Tenggara. There are many definitions of food security, but I just take some. Food security is defined as a state of affairs where all people at all times have access to safe and nutritious food to maintain a healthy and active life. It's from FAO. Therefore, food security has three dimensions: availability, accessibility, and affordability. Sometimes accessibility and affordability can be combined into one. So actually on the availability and accessibility, but we can differentiate. Yeah. Availability of sufficient quantities of food in appropriate quality supplied through domestic production or imports. Accessibility of households and individuals to appropriate food for a nutritious diet, and affordability of individuals to consume food according to their respective socioeconomic conditions, cultural backgrounds, and preferences. From usage definition, when all people at all times have food, physical, and economic access to sufficient food to meet their dietary needs for the productive and healthy life. Then from Pariseo, my boss in UBC, University of British Columbia, said that there is better definition according to him. Better definition of food security. Food security is measured by the ratio of food expenditure to a family budget or income. Achieving food security keep food expenditure share of family income below some critical percentage. In 1996, Indonesian Constitution number 7, concerning food, defines food security as a condition where there is sufficient food for every household, which is reflected by individuality of sufficient food, both in quantity and quality, that is safe, evenly distributed, and accessible. In this case, food consists of food and drinks in primary or processed form, including drinking water. Sequentially, the term food security in the said constitution is delineated as follows. First, sufficient food security is defined as food availability in a broad sense. Includes food and drink derived from plants, livestock, and fish, and their derivatives, in amounts suitable for each citizen to meet the demand for carbohydrate, protein, fat, vitamin, and mineral useful for growth, health, and physical and mental strength. Second one, availability of safe food implies availability of food that is free from biological, chemical, and other kinds of contamination that can disturb, damage, and endanger people's health. Furthermore, it should not be forbidden by religious law. Third, availability of evenly distributed food means that food is available at all times, in every location throughout Indonesia. Fourth, accessibility of equally distributed food means that food is physically and economically accessible for every household in terms of accessible distance and price at all times. Accessibility means technically, accessibility is a function of food distribution. Food production is conducted in certain areas with appropriate agro-ecosystem for its food crop. On the other hand, food consumers are evenly distributed in all regions. Therefore, food should be distributed in such a way so that every household has access to it. This can be implemented through a market mechanism. If the market is unable to function, the government's role is required to overcome market failure. Economically, the main aspect in accessibility is capacity to buy food. This is connected with consumers' income and price of food of the community's real income in food. These economic variables are connected with several derivative variables, such as income share for food, relative price of food to other products, and relative price of food regards to other food products. Food economic system. Food security is achieved through efforts of food economic system, which consists of subsystems of availability, distribution, and consumption that interact continuously. Development of availability of subsystem includes management of stability and continuity of food supply obtained from local production, reserve, and import and export. Development of distribution subsystems includes management that ensures people's physical and economic accessibility to food across region and across time, and stability of strategic food price. Development of consumption subsystem includes food management at the local level and the household level to ensure individuals access to food in the amount with nutrition, reliability, and variety that meet their need and choice. Output of food security. These three subsystems are implemented by many parties, such as producers, processors, traders, and consumers, assisted by institutions that mutually interact within regions and across regions. The expected output from food security development is the fulfillment of human rights to food at all times, with adequate amount, nutrition, and reliability in accordance with their choice for healthy and productive daily life. By satisfying the above need continuously, human resource quality of future generations is expected to improve. Development of other sectors shall be properly implemented to improve national economic security and national security. The main food in Indonesia is rice. In general, food consumption is still dominated by carbohydrate foods, particularly rice. Rice alone contributes more than 60% of energy consumption. Through the share of rice in household expenditure has gone down to about 7 to 11%, depending on whether one is referring to urban or rural areas. Daily food supplies has increased from 2013 35 kilocalorie per capita in 68 to 2,887 kilocalorie per capita in 1992. Until 1980, food energy consumption remained below 2,500 kilocalorie per capita, but this was sufficient to meet the targeted daily calorie intake or actual consumption of 2,150 kilocalorie per capita per day, a target considered adequate for Indonesian to live a healthy life. Supply and calorie consumption. The total calorie supplies from the average Indonesian today is close to the ceiling level of 3,000 kilocalorie per day. However, the consumption of the lowest income group is still below 1,780 kilocalorie per day, which is the minimum calorie intake required to prevent malnutrition. This is about 80% of the minimum requirement for daily calorie intake of 2,150 kilocalorie. It is estimated that 3.35% of the population is considered to be malnourished. This group has the tendency to increase their energy consumption, particularly carbohydrates, when their income increases. In contrast, carbohydrate consumption among higher income groups has declined, as this group was shifted to foods with more protein. This confirmed that the aggregate calorie consumption will not change much from its present level, and that an average daily energy supply of 3,000 kilocalorie per capita will become the ceiling level for energy consumption in Indonesia. Food energy supply is still dominated by cereals, particularly rice, which accounted for more than 60% of total energy consumed. Rice consumption, particularly direct household consumption, has already reached its peak, as reported by Central Bureau of Statistics. Direct per capita household rice consumption increased from 112.42 kg in 1978 to 117.68 kg in 19. After which, it declined to 115.62 kg in 94. In contrast, per capita rice consumption outside the household has increased from 6,860 kg in 78 to 15.02 kg in 1994. The market rise in per capita rice consumption outside the household is most likely due to the sharp increase of women participating in the labor market and urbanization, in addition to increases in per capita income. Average total per capita rice consumption, both inside and outside the home, is recently estimated at 131.81 kg per year, and it is expected to remain at this level up through the end of this country. This is number third, the biggest consumption of rice in the world. Rural and urban consumption. When the data are disaggregated into rural and urban rice consumption, it is found that per capita is lower in urban areas than in rural areas. However, consumption outside the household in urban areas is higher than it is in rural areas. The movement of labor from agriculture into industry and service concentrated in urban areas will increase rice and food consumption in the short run. But over the medium term, rice consumption will flatten out and then decrease as a result of rising incomes. Per capita apparent consumption reach its highest level at 155 programs year in 1998. When I graduated from UPRB. Whereas household consumption was 135.27 kilograms per year in 1990. Since then, both apparent and actual consumption have been declining slowly. Average per capita apparent consumption rise also recently reached a stable level at about 147 kilograms per year, which is slightly below the level of consumption during the 1988 to 1992 periods. For the lowest income groups, which have a high positive income elasticity of demand for rice, average per capita rice consumption is expected to remain flat. The belief that rice consumption will fall in coming years may require careful review. Because of very strong pressure from lower income classes to push rice consumption up as a result of successful poverty alleviation programs in recent years. A similar trend for cereal consumption should also hold. The aggregate energy consumption as measured by average daily caloric availability also has reached the level of nearly 3,000 kilocalorie, the level at which is expected to stabilize. Nevertheless, calorie consumption from cereal should start decline. This trend is in line with the natural shift in consumption from staples into processed and protein-rich foods. I talk about food international trade. International trade increase both total and food. Later on you will see the table. USA is the biggest both exporter and importer for food. Indonesia is out of 15 top exporter and importer. But I think Thailand is inside the 15 top exporter of rice. International trade will increase welfare. I think this graph, I think for economists and agricultural economists is familiar with this, that this graph indicating that for countries involving in international trade, the welfare of the people will increase. This suggests that the countries should improve in international trade. Yeah, in terms of welfare effect, it's positive. But maybe there is also negative effect on risk. Because improving in international trade is also promoting risk, especially if the good credit is very thin. And the consumption, total consumption of the country is very big, like Indonesia. Indonesia is total consumption is very big, very much bigger than the good credit internationally. That's if Indonesia depend on the internal trade, it's very dangerous. That's different with Singapore. Singapore is have no production of food, but Singapore is a small country, so you need only a small portion of the world international trade. So for Singapore, there's no problem not having domestic production. But for Indonesia, if the domestic production is not sufficient, that's dangerous. Trade for food range from thin rice is thin, I think it's about 6%, to thick coffee is about 60 to 80%. Later on we will see the table. Share of international trade tuber production for food increase. So most of the world product will trade, I think international trade will be increasing. Import as source of food availability can be used if the country has comparative advantage. And also can be used if the country has capability to import. This one is can be retained if the country have export earnings more than the value of food import. And also if there is big enough of internal trade volume compared to the domestic consumption. But there are disadvantages of food import, especially if thinness of food international trade. If food international trade is thin, and then if there is price fluctuation, because the world trade of food is not under the structure of proper competition. So there are many factors that influence the price fluctuation. If foreign government policies, if there are foreign government policies, other countries, especially protection, like in Japan, the process is more than 100%. Subsidy, like United States and Europe countries, has big subsidy on food production, regulation, etc. International politics, sometimes developed countries has embargo, political tension, war. That's very risky. International environment. Now we have climate change. Since 25 or 30 years ago, I never seen that Philippines or Spanish during the summer program is raining. But when I came here, there is raining. That's a sign of climate change. Flood, frost, other natural disasters. In Indonesia and also in the world, recently there are many natural disasters. Unlike Philippines, before there are many natural disasters, now still many. Use of imports. If the country has comparative advantage, they should export, not import. If they don't have comparative advantage, they can import safely, as long as volume of world trade is big enough compared to domestic consumption. Import staple food or strategic food at minimum level. Don't import staple food or strategic food high enough. Indonesia import wheat 100% of the domestic consumption. It's very dangerous. Import soybean about 60%. Import sugar, I think about 15%. That's the very big risk. If you look at the import situation, actually agriculture or food trade is small compared to the production. Agricultural balance of trade still surplus. But food crops and animal husbandry subsector are decreasing. This means that imports, the value of import is higher than the volume of export. large imports and biggest import dependency with 100%. Soybean 62%, beef 38%, sugar 13.5%. That's the most rich commodity. Here is the table. The total availability of food supplies in Indonesia. In 70 to 72, the availability of food is 2,090 calorie per capita per day, and then 2007 to 2008, about 3,145 calorie per capita per day. So that's increasing. But there is the problem to make Indonesia is not secure. So after the title is food security, it will have a tell that Indonesia is food insecurity. Because there are many number of people under poverty line. Maybe on the average, it's okay. But if you look at some group of people, there are many people under poverty line. That's insecure. From 1998 to 2007, there is a number of people under poverty line from. The absolute number is decreasing. In total, and rural also decreasing. But the percentage almost the same. From 1988, this one, 24.2. percent of the total population. And then 19, 18, 16, 17, 16.6 in 2007. This one is the percent of total population of the rural, and then this one is percentage of the rural world from 64 to 63.4. So stable means not good. Energy or protein availability and consumption. Yeah, if you talk about the average, it looks good. This one availability 2035, then it moves to 2200, and protein 80.33. Recommended 57 in consumption, one recommended. So the consumption is more than the recommended one. So it's good on the average. At national level, food availability is more than enough, sufficient. But at macro level, about 20% of households consume less than dietary recommended. And this one, this people is you. The problem is the distribution and affordability. If there is poor people, they don't have affordability. And if there's no good distribution, the domestic production is mostly in Java. Part of Sulawesi, part of Sumatra, part of Kalimantan. Outside Java, mostly are deficit in terms of food production. Papua is very far from Java. the price of rice is much higher than that in Java. Indonesian food production, if you talk about the production, domestic production is this one is the production, and all of that, this one is staple food, pati, pork, cassava, this one is staple food, this one sugar is strategic food, CPO, crude palm oil, also strategic food, the growth rate is like this. Yeah, every commodity has grown, but still not enough. If you talk about the food import dependency, the crude palm oil, zero, because we exporting to other countries. Rice, about 4%. Maize 8%, sugar 13.5%, beef 38%, soybean 61.8%, wheat 100%. So this one is the most risky commodity. The main staple food in Indonesia is rice. If you talk about rice production in Indonesia from 2004 to 2008, the area harvested increased, the yield rate also increased, that's why the production increased, the growth rate is positive. Food balance of rice, rice supply and demand in Indonesia. In 2008, production 60.28, production 24.14, consumption 51.7, no import, and in stock at least. There is no import here. You know why? There is a secret here. Because during this year, there is a potential campaign, so this one must be good performance. If compared to the other ASEAN countries, Indonesia contribute 30% of the ASEAN rice production. Paddy product in Indonesia was 20% higher than the average paddy product in ASEAN. This one production, Indonesia 57.61 million ton, that's the highest. Second one is Vietnam, Myanmar, Thailand, Philippines, Cambodia, Malaysia, Laos, Brunei, Singapore. And then productivity, I think Indonesia is second. 4.71 ton per hectare, the highest is Vietnam. 4.98 ton per hectare. Thailand, the main exporter of rice, the productivity is only 2.94. Actually, Thailand has no productivity, but because the area is very large and the consumption is not so large, that's why Thailand has the biggest exporter, I think, in Asia. Trend of rice import in Indonesia, this one. We have the biggest import in 1980. 13.4 kilogram per capita, and then what is what 1995 16 kilogram per capita. This is the highest
Court.
Import major food commodities, rice, maize, soybean, sugar, wheat, beef, milk. This one the trend of food import. We compare to the coefficient of variation between international price and domestic price. That's interesting is that most of the prices of international has coefficient of variation bigger than the domestic price, except this one soybean. The soybean almost the same, international and domestic price, but others international price has a bigger fluctuation than domestic because the country has policy to stabilize the price, especially rice. This one perfectly. World export in agricultural product. World export. This one the trend of the world production. Volume of world production and then unit value and then value world export value. All I'm teaching. The top 15 food exporting and importing countries. Like what I said, that the USA is the biggest exporter and importer. And then France, Canada, Netherlands, Germany. The deficit food trade is the USA deficit. And then China, and then Italy. I think China also, yeah, China deficit. The export of the surplus, the country has surplus trade is France, Canada, Netherlands, Thailand, among Asian countries. Approximate share of world production traded across borders. This one, coffee is 80%, tea 40%, soybean 30%, sugar 30%, bananas 20%, wheat 17%, food grain 11%, rice 6%. So it means that this area, especially for the staple food, is very riskier if we depend on the international trade. So we suggest that the country should maintain approach to self-sufficiency of this food, but unfortunately COVID we don't have domestic production, so all of them are imported. I think that's a situation of food insecurity in Indonesia. And the next one is policy to increase food security. This policy is my opinion based on many references. But there are government policies. I think it's interesting to know the government policies, not my opinion about the policies to increase the security of rice. That's the national policy. I just copied from the Director General of Food Security of Indonesia. National Policy on Food Security. Access to food is the most basic human right. Okay. I just took and protest strengthening food supply by maximizing available resources in a sustainable manner, improving food distribution system to guarantee a stable food supply and public access to food, encouraging diversified food consumption, defending and promoting food security. And then policy on supply side, this one, and then I'll direct to the policy implementation. Expanding total agricultural area with minimal environment impact. Actually, we still have plenty of land which is not grown by rice or food, especially in eastern part of Indonesia, like Papua. So that's the reserve for land expansion. Conserving and rehabilitating existing agricultural land. Management and maintenance of water supply system, especially for irrigation. Now we have damaged irrigated, which should be improved, should be maintained. Introducing improved varieties and cultural practices, improving post-harvest technology, strengthening extension system, and promote collaboration between farmers, encourage investment, and develop a productive financing system. Program on food production, empowering farmers to implement recommended technology on farming practice through increasing efficiency and technology and information delivery, improving accessibility and affordability of farm inputs, promoting better post-harvest handling, providing output rice incentive through government procurement price for rice, not block the government agency who handle the rice procurement, buys about 2 to 2.5 million metric ton of rice annually. Procurement price is set usually higher than market price during peak harvesting season. This program was designed as a movement directed at various level of governments and stakeholders. Directed towards three cluster of target groups. Direct assistance. Target groups about 19.1 million households. We have distribution of rice for poor. One family is given 15 kilogram per month at subsidized price of 1,600. The market price is about 5,000, 5 to 6,000 per kilogram. So it means that this subsidy price is about one third of market price. Community health assistance. School operational assistant, primary and junior high, was in Indonesian language. So it's mean that from the elementary school and high school, student is free, no tuition fee. Special assistant for 3.9 million of very poor households. Self-help community empowerment to provide to teach what you said, covering 4,270 subdescripts, provide community direct assistance to generate rural economy activities, then macro and small scale enterprise in empowerment. The target group is micro and small scale entrepreneurs to promote economic growth and create job opportunity and source of income of the lower income class at village level provide microcredit as working poor as in Indonesian language, credit usaha rakyat, as working capital for micro and small scale economic activities. Program designed by the Ministry of Agriculture, Rural Activities Development in 11 towns and villages, provide working capital of 100 million rupiah per village. The program short-term assistance, this is done by a long time, but now no more, so I will not discuss about this. I think that's all about food security and insecurity in Indonesia. I hope if you can discuss or ask a question. I will answer if any. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mashmuri.